Duke Paoa Kahanamoku, better known as the Duke, is still regarded today as one of the world's greatest aquatic sportsmen of all time. Participant in five Olympic Games dating back to his gold medal performance in the 1912 competition in Stockholm, Sweden, this quiet-mannered, muscular Hawaiian beach boy from Waikiki captured the hearts and respect of countless generations of admirers from around the globe. The Duke taught us all the meaning of brotherhood and love. Of the many fans from around the globe, no stronger group exists than those who have grown up in Duke's own backyard, here in Hawaii.
I remember when I was a kid, Duke used to come out all the time just to go out for a paddle or take a swim by himself. It was mostly just to be alone, I think, with his thoughts in the ocean. He had this lifelong relationship with the ocean. It was quite unique, I think, for modern Hawaii, but quite natural to Duke.
Duke Kahanamoku was my neighbor. We lived in the duck ponds, about approximately 100 acres, all in swamps, with a series of date trees planted. Originally, that area was scheduled to be a date farm. It was supposed to be commercial. That location was on corner McCully and Kalakaua Avenue. And there was a streetcar that turns right smack at the corner. And we lived about two blocks away from Duke Kahanamoku. Yeah, he was living on the Paoa property, which they were related to. And Duke Kahanamoku was a very humble person and very, what I would call, a first-class Hawaiian.
Growing up with my famous brother, the whole family never took advantage of the name. I never have. I'm 76 today, proud of it, because we kept it clean. I came from a beautiful parents, mother and father. My mother came from the island of Kauai. She was the daughter of the high chief there. My father came from, I think it was Maui, Hawaii. And they were great parents. So they had 14 youngsters. I'm the 14th. I only knew six boys and three girls. But some died before Brother Duke and after. So the ones that lived through my lifetime was Brother Duke, David, Bernice, Bill, who we lost yesterday, Samuel, Kapiolani, Mariah, Louis, and myself. My brother Louis is over in the corner. My sister Bernice and Hilo. Well, when I grew up, yes, my brother Duke was the eldest, and I always had to listen to him. I always looked up to him.
I came over here in December 1938. I didn't meet Duke until about a month or so afterwards. I was introduced to him by his brother Sam. But I wanted to meet Duke because I had read about him when I was a little girl in school. I'd read about him in a movie magazine where he had been discovered by Douglas Fairbanks and Mary Pickford. When I heard the name Duke Kahanamoku, of course I couldn't pronounce it then, I had no idea how to pronounce it. I said, that's the man I want to meet. Well, I think I met all of his five brothers first, and little by little I met Duke. And it was love at first sight for Duke, which was very lucky for me.
There was one experience. We boated from here to Maui, overnight in Maui, and from Maui to the Big Island, the channel known as Alanui Haha Channel. And it's supposedly one of the roughest channels in the world when it's really, when it's real bad. And there were four of us. I mean, we were hanging on, trying to, you know, stay in the boat as much as we can because it was so rough. And Duke was just standing there like nothing was fazing him, you know? And he turned to us and said, "What's the matter, boy? It's too rough for you, you know?" And, but I tell you, that was a day I thought we were, you know, going to see the end of Hawaii.
Duke was a very special individual to me. I can recall several instances being with him and learning from his great wisdom. He had a novel style to his character that I can recall very vividly. Remember one incident, we were at Huntington Beach, and Duke was the guest of honor for the United States Surfing Championships. And at the award ceremony on the beach, after the conclusion of the contest, there were about 5,000 spectators there. And they called up the senior men's division and awarded the prizes from fifth up to first place. Well, they got to the third place award, called a gentleman up, and he came up, picked up his trophy, faced the audience, and threw it directly into a garbage can and walked off stage in disgust. I was really upset, and I was sitting with Duke, and I turned to him and I said, "How about that, Duke? What do you think of that guy and what he did?" And Duke turned to me and looked at me square in the eyes, and he says, "Gee, Paul, these guys really want to win, don't they?" And it kind of took all the wind out of my sails, but that was the kind of guy he was, a real special fellow.
Ralph Edwards contacted me here in Hawaii and said that he was going to ask Duke to appear on This Is Your Life, but it had to be very secretive. Nobody was supposed to know, only the people concerned. And it had to keep it a dark, dark secret. He asked all the rest of his family. They were all living then in 1957. So we all kept silent. Then we went over to the mainland separately so that nobody would suspect anything. Duke especially wouldn't suspect anything. So he got him over there, supposedly on a business trip. And Ralph called him and said, "I'd like to have you come on the stage to see this set that we have of a Hawaiian village and see if you approve of it." That was the way he lured him onto the stage.
Hello, nice seeing you.
Good, you know the Duke. Duke Kahanamoku.
Duke Kahanamoku. Good to see you. Duke, last time I saw you in Hawaii. You know.
So Duke goes on and looks at this Hawaiian village and said, "Well, it looks all right," or whatever. And then Ralph pounced on him and handed him the book and said, "Duke, this is your life.
Famous champion, Olympic swimmer, and sheriff of Honolulu, Hawaii, tonight, this is your life." Let's tell the story, ladies and gentlemen, of a little Hawaiian boy who became the most famous swimmer in the world, participated in 5 Olympic Games, and used his great speed and power in a most heroic way.
So one day he was on the beach with some people sitting, and there was this cruiser going out, people going fishing. I don't know whether you remember this or not, but he was on the beach, standing up there, and these people that he was with on the beach, he's kind of worried about him, what he was, what's up to. He never said a word. But he had the feeling that that boat was going to capsize because they were in the wrong lane. It was too close, just within the reef and the wave. Sure enough, there he goes. So what does he do? He takes his surfboard, he paddles out there, he brings one in, he brings two in, he brings three. When I get the fourth was all tangled up in the net. This is what I was told. And he couldn't get that guy out of it. He was so mad, he was sad about it, but he got the other. I think he saved 7 lives that day, it was 6. All by himself. And that's one thing about my brother, which I always loved, never will forget, because He was a great man. He'd never sat around and wait for the reporters. He just went to sleep. He let somebody else tell it all about him. You know, this and that. Reporters, what happened here on the beach? And Duke is like that till the day he died. You see, he tried to do what's right for the people, and he loved people.
And I want to thank you again for the rescuing me and saving my life.
I do not think anybody can measure up to Duke's personality. He had a tremendous personality and a tremendous warmth, and always meeting people and giving the regular aloha spirit. And that, in my estimation, is the, not as a, only as a swimmer, but on account of his personality that made him so famous.
The name Duke was handed down to you from your daddy.
That's right.
Where do your brothers and sisters live, Duke?
Well, they're all in Honolulu.
They are? They're here in Hollywood to help us tell your story. Here's Bernice, Sister Bernice, Kapi'olani. Oh, thank you, Kapi'olani.
You betcha. This is David, right? Hey, man. Here's Bill. Here's Sam, right here. And here's Louie. Hey, Louie. And here is Sargent.
For your lovely wife, Nadine Kahanamoku.
But his favorite meal, his number one favorite food, was poi, a big bowl of poi, and a can of salmon, chilled. Open the can and get an onion and quarter the onion and the big bowl of poi, and that was his favorite meal. Period. His second favorite was Argentine canned corned beef fried with onions. And again, a great big bowl of poi. Well, when I say a big bowl, I mean a big bowl like that. And those were his two favorites. But I started out with French cooking and trying to have all these different sauces and be very lovely. And he'd say, "Baby, where's the ketchup?" He always called me baby. He said, "Where's the ketchup?" And I said, "You can't put ketchup on that. That's a hollandaise sauce, or it's sauce béarnaise, whatever." "Well, I like ketchup." Then finally he got to the point and he said, "Baby, just cook it plain."
Everything Duke did athletically was championship performance. His surfing ability, he was way beyond his time. Some of the things he did with a surfboard were profound in their day, considering also the equipment he was working with. When Duke was surfing as a young man in the earlier part of this century, he was surfing on surfboards that were 15 or 16 feet long and weighed 120 or 130 pounds. I'd venture to say that many kids nowadays couldn't even carry Duke's board to the water, much less surf it.
This is kind of a big wave now. Come up this way. Make your feet up that way. That way. Toe lift, go. Balance. Move up. The wave small, go forward. The wave big, you go back. And when you get back, you want to turn right, you just go. And that whole thing turns. You want to go left, you go. And all up, it's right in here.
Duke was so humble that he prevailed on me to be humble and be kind also. He was a man of tremendous stature, but very humble and down to earth. It was a rare quality, but among the Hawaiians, it was a quality of unusual strength.
The only man who could have defeated you, your former opponent and now close friend, a man who himself broke the established world record, Johnny Wyatt-Miller.
Do
you recognize him now that he's Jungle Jim?
Boy, he is Jungle.
Oh, the kids love this guy. Duke actually helped you to beat him, didn't he, Johnny?
Yes, he did. You know, we trained together in the Olympic Games.
Yes.
And this big lug, he just gave me all the confidence in the world.
Well, this is a thrill.
Contemporary people, especially contemporary young people, realize is that, that this name they hear, Duke Kahanamoku, was a real man. And he was a man that gained his respect and his honor in our society through just being a good man and not through being a capitalist or being a big businessman or being a talented, devoted, wonderful man. He was, in my estimation, the embodiment of aloha. He always, Duke was the type of person who might have felt, had ill feelings about a subject or someone, but he never let you know about it. The guy always had a smile on his face and always a good word for everybody he met. And he was not caught up in the modern day-to-day rat race that seems to consume so many people nowadays. He had, as I said earlier, a great sense of value in life. He valued those things that money can neither buy nor destroy to a certain extent. He valued human relationships. He valued his relationship with the ocean and with his lifestyle, with his ability to play in the ocean. And these attributes, I think, are very special.